Is there anyone else out there?
It's a star. I must have gone through a wormhole.
As you gaze into the infinite expanse of the night sky, you are observing but a fraction of our universe's countless stars, many with their own planetary systems. This is the heart of the Fermi Paradox. The contradictory estimates of high probabilities for extraterrestrial life and the lack of evidence or contact. With the countless celestial bodies, some possibly habitable, it's a conundrum that continues to baffle us. So we find ourselves asking, are we truly alone in the universe?
Some people still look up, and you can't help but wonder, with all these stars, we know enough to know that they're stars just like the sun, and if they're planets, how could you not wonder if there's life? And if there's life, is it intelligent life? And if it's intelligent life, could they be smarter than us? If they're smarter than us, should we be scared of them? My best guess is that the universe is teeming with life, but that complex life might be much rarer. Here's the argument. You have the timeline of the Earth. Earth is born, and this is today. That's 4.5 billion years. Now, put this planet out there, and some planets are born yesterday, some were born at the beginning of the universe. You don't know when in the timeline of a planet you're going to land there. So here's Earth. Throw a dart at the timeline. Most of the time the dart hits Earth, there's only single-celled life. We spent 3.5 billion years as single-celled life on Earth. And then we have something called the Cambrian explosion of life, where chemistry of the atmosphere changed. There's oxygen. Oxygen is like rocket fuel for complex life. And life now has the carte blanche to become complex because the system can support it. And now you get limbs and detectors like eyes and sensors. And it's a stunning development in the fossil record of life on Earth. And so then you'll have complex life. Now ask, how often would you throw the dart, will you find intelligent life that we define as intelligent? And so if Earth is any measure of anything, throwing darts at planets that we might land on, who is to say that we're going to land right at that moment where what we call intelligence has arisen?
Enrico Fermi, a renowned physicist, once asked, where is everybody? This simple yet powerful question encapsulates what we now call the Fermi Paradox. It points out the contrast between the high probability estimates for the existence of extraterrestrial civilizations and the staggering silence we've experienced so far. Imagine the universe as an immense ocean, teeming with billions of galaxies. These galaxies are like archipelagos, each composed of countless stars. Recent discoveries suggest that most stars likely harbor their own planetary systems. It's mind-boggling to comprehend the sheer number of worlds out there, and with it, the possibilities of life. Our understanding of our place in the cosmos is constantly evolving, broadening with every new exoplanet discovery. The launch of the James Webb Space Telescope, or JWST, has expanded our cosmic perspective even further. This monumental instrument may soon provide tantalizing clues to our quest by detecting biosignatures in the atmosphere of distant alien worlds. So in this vast cosmic ocean, filled with galaxies, stars, and planets, can we really be the only ones sailing?
These are discoveries that deeply influence our understanding of our place in the universe. So what would be next in this flow? I would say the discovery of alien intelligence, alien life at all, then we're not alone as biology, and then alien intelligence. That would signal a change in the human condition that maybe we cannot foresee or imagine. A feature of James Webb that was not its original design parameters. What I mean by that is James Webb was conceived to observe galaxies being born in the early universe. Well, a telescope that can do that has the power to do other things as well. And so when people said, well, what else can it do? And you lay out the rest of its portfolio, oh my gosh, it can observe the atmospheres of planets moving in front of their host stars, because then the light comes from the host star, moves through the atmosphere on the edge of the planet, and then makes its way to your telescope. And so that original light from the star has been imprinted by gaseous signatures in the atmosphere of the planet, the exoplanet. Right now, we have a catalog of gases that we're pretty sure you will only find or primarily find in the presence of life on the surface of those planets. So these are biomarkers, biosignatures. James Webb is participating in that exercise. Now, again, these aren't aliens waving to us or landing in their flying saucers. But if life influences its environment in the way we think, the James Webb will participate on that frontier of discovery.
Many intriguing solutions have been proposed to resolve the Fermi paradox, each one painting a unique narrative of our cosmic journey. A leading explanation is the Great Filter Hypothesis. Imagine a cosmic gauntlet of challenges that every civilization must face. These could range from the development of life itself to the invention of technology without self-destruction. The filter could lie in our past, suggesting we've overcome the odds, or perhaps it's yet to come, presenting a future hurdle to our survival. It's a sobering thought that maybe civilizations tend to self-destruct before they can reach out to the stars. Alternatively, perhaps extraterrestrial life is out there, but it's simply too alien for us to recognize. Our current understanding and search methods are biased towards life as we know it. It's possible that other life forms are based on different chemistries or inhabit environments we've deemed inhospitable. Could it be that the universe is teeming with transcension civilizations that have moved beyond our physical dimension? Or is it possible that we live in a zoo or sanctuary where advanced civilizations actively avoid contact with us? Despite our strides in technology and astronomical observation, we're still grappling with these profound questions. Our universe, vast and mysterious, remains silent for now. So with all the galaxies, all the stars, all the worlds, all the possible chances for life out there, are we alone? Is our beautiful, vibrant Earth the exception in the cosmos, or the rule? As we look deeper into the cosmic void, we continue our search for answers.
Consider a couple of fundamental facts that has been gleaned in the past 60 years. If you had asked your chemistry teacher 50 years ago, once you looked at that mysterious chart of boxes that sat in front of your class, the periodic table of elements, where did those elements come from? The chemistry teacher would actually not have an answer for you. They'll say, well, dig them out of the Earth. That's not where they come from. It took modern astrophysics to determine the origin of the chemical elements. We observe stars. We know what goes on in their center. They explode, laying bare their contents. And what we have discovered is that the elements of the periodic table, that which we are made of, derive from the actions of stars that have manufactured the elements, exploded, scattered their enriched guts across the galaxy, contaminating or enriching gas clouds that then form a next generation of stars populated by planets and possibly life. And so when you look at the ingredients of the universe, the number one ingredient is hydrogen. Next is helium, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen. Those are the top ingredients in the universe. Now you say, well, okay, that's kind of cool. Well, and you look at Earth, because we like thinking of ourselves as special, we say, oh, we're special. But what are we made of? In fact, if you rank the elements in the human body, number one in the human body is hydrogen, matches the universe. Number two is oxygen, matches the universe. Number three, carbon, matches the universe. Number four, nitrogen, matches the universe. We learned in the last 50 years that, of course, not only do we exist in this universe, it is the universe itself that exists within us. Because when you look up at the night sky, it's no longer we're here and that's there, it's that we are part of that. And that association, for me, is actually quite enlightening and ennobling and enriching, looking up at the night sky and finding a sense of belonging. And so, now are we alone in the universe? We're made of the most common ingredients there are. And our chemistry is based on carbon. Carbon is the most chemically active ingredient in the entire periodic table. If you were to find a chemistry on which to base something really complex called life, you would base it on carbon. Carbon is like the fourth most abundant ingredient in the universe. You can make more molecules out of carbon than you can all other kinds of molecules combined. So if we ask ourselves, are we alone in the universe? It would be inexcusably egocentric to suggest that we are alone in the cosmos. The chemistry is too rich to declare that. The universe, too vast. There are more stars in the universe than grains of sand in all the beaches of the world. There are more stars in the universe than all the sounds and words ever uttered by all humans who have ever lived. To say we're alone in the universe. No, we haven't found life outside of Earth yet. We're looking. Haven't looked very far yet, but we're looking. And how about life on Earth? Is it hard to form? Just because we don't know how to do it in the lab doesn't mean nature had problems.
So it may be, given that information, that given the right ingredients, which are everywhere, life may be inevitable, an inevitable consequence of complex chemistry.
In our quest to answer the profound question of our cosmic solitude, we've unlocked remarkable insights about our universe and our place within it. We've peered into the distant reaches of our galaxy, discovered thousands of exoplanets, and yet the silence of the cosmos persists. The Fermi Paradox continues to challenge us, driving our curiosity and innovation. It encourages us to contemplate the great filter, our own survival, and the nature of life itself. It forces us to push our boundaries, both scientific and philosophical, and compels us to strive for a better understanding of our universe. So as we continue our voyage on this cosmic sea, we keep asking, are we alone? It's a question as boundless as the universe itself, a testament to our insatiable curiosity and our enduring hope. It's a question that defines our existence and our relentless pursuit for knowledge. Perhaps the answer lies just around the corner, in a future discovery, or perhaps is destined to remain a mystery. But isn't the search itself part of the beauty of being alive in this vast cosmos? For in the grand story of the universe, isn't the question of our loneliness just as inspiring as the answers we seek?